Eric Harlan. This video is about the Solarfilm range of model aircraft covering materials. We do 7 different covering materials, and the reason we have so many different ones is that there's such a wide range of model aircraft that are built nowadays. For example, we go from the very small ones, like this small rubber driven scale model I've got here, up to the very large models, like this model of a B-52 here, which I think is about 12 feet wingspan. I've got the 7 covering materials in front of me. We've got the light ones, the 2 light ones for light span and fibre film. We have 3 iron on plastic films, solar film, solar span and solar coat. And there are also 2 fabrics, Solartex and Glosstex. Now, as we move up that range of covering materials, we find that the models change from very small light models going heavier and larger until the very largest models are usually covered with the fabrics. The important thing is that it's very simple really, because all these 7 different materials, they all work in exactly the same way. They all have a plastic film or a fabric on them, and that film or fabric will shrink when it's heated. This is how we get the material to tie. They all have an adhesive. It's a type of adhesive called a heat seal adhesive. When it's heated with an iron, it becomes sticky. And this is what sticks the material onto the model. So, provided you learn to use one of these materials successfully, then with a little bit of extra practice, you can easily adapt and use any of the other materials. Most beginners are rather confused by these 7 different materials, but the important thing is to learn one of them, to use one of them properly first, and then you can transfer to the others. Some of them are more easier to use than others. If you're a beginner, I recommend that you start off with either solar film or the fabric Solartex. Those 2 are the easiest ones to use, and you've much better chance of getting a good result by starting with those 2. There are also other materials in the solar film range. There's some materials here, a trim material. This is a sticky back material, and this is used for doing colour schemes, like I've got on this wing here. All these have been cut out afterwards from this solar trim material, and they're just rubbed on the surface and they stick on. Also, if you want to do insignia, like this American star, or some invasion stripes like I've got on here, then you use these trim materials. This wing is looks like it's covered in sheet metal. It's actually been covered with some of the aluminium fibre film, and this is the way we simulate a metal covering on an aircraft. There are also some other materials involved, liquids. There's a series of paints called Solarlac. These are made to match the exact colours of the films we do. We also have a material called clear coat, which is a fuel proofer. It is used completely differently to the traditional fuel proofers. So this is dealt with fairly fully on the instruction sheets, which come with every roll or every sheet of the product. So you will need some of this. And the final product we've got is this balsamoc. This is a heat seal adhesive which is applied as a white water-based emulsion. It's applied on the model and allowed to dry, and then it becomes a heat seal adhesive. The tools you're going to use are very, very simple. I've got them all here. The most important one is this tool, which is a small iron. It's a modeler's iron. You can use a domestic iron, but this is much easier and much more convenient to use, and it's got an accurate thermostat on it. You're going to use the other routine modeler's equipment, straight edges, steel rulers, sharp blades, scissors, a dope brush, and some sticky tape, and you'll also need a sock cloth. But with all just that simple set of tools, you can produce these coverings on a model aircraft. Well, when we come to cover a model aircraft, we can't wrap it up like a parcel in a single sheet of material. We can't get a single sheet of material to fit round the parts of a model aircraft. What we do, we cover each separate surface with a separate piece of covering material. For example, this fuselage here, the bottom of the fuselage has been covered with one piece of film. This side has been covered with a separate piece of film. The other side has a third piece of film, and the top surface is covered with a fourth piece. And those four pieces are put on in sequence, and where they meet, they're actually overlapped slightly, about a quarter of an inch or 5 millimetres. The wing here it's been made in two panels, a left and a right hand panel, and we always cover the underside first, and we'll use one piece on this side of the wing, a second piece here, then we'll move to the top surface, a third piece on here, and a fourth piece on here. And once again, we overlap the pieces where they meet. That's the leading edge and the trailing edge. They are overlapped slightly. When we study all the different kinds of model aircraft and analyse what we're doing when we cover them, we find that whatever the size, whatever the shape of the model is, we're going to be doing one of three different tasks. And I've got the three different types of covering we're going to do here. We're going to be covering what is called an open framework structure, like this wing here, made of ribs and spars, with a lot of open spaces in between. That's an open structure. Or we'll be covering a solid wood surface, like this veneered foam wing. Or we shall be doing what is called a double curvature, like this wing tip here. It curves in two directions, and at first sight it appears impossible that we're going to get a flat sheet of covering material to cover that double curvature. To do these three different tasks, the open structure, the solid surface, and the double curvature, we have to use slightly different methods. But provided you can learn how to do these three simple tasks, then you will be able to cover any model aircraft at all. I think I should stress at this point that those three phrases, open structure, solid surface, and double curvature, are very important phrases. If you're covering a model and you're actually doing one panel, you must decide for yourself, what am I doing? Am I doing this one, or the double curvature? It's a bit like a cook when he's cooking in the kitchen. There are key words in cookery, things like bake, boil, fry. Those are important words. Once he's identified whether he's baking, boiling, or frying, he knows which tools to use and what method he's going to use. And with covering model aircraft, it's exactly the same way. So we're going to do these three tasks in sequence. We're going to use slightly different methods for each one, but I'll do those one after the other, and then you will see how simple it is. First, start with the open structure. I'm going to cover this wing panel, and I'm going to use some Solartex. I'm using Solartex on this because this type of structure is often a little bit flexible, and we need a stronger material to stiffen it up. So we cut our piece of Solartex, we cut it a little bit oversized, leave a bit to spare at the edges. We strip off the liner, the clear plastic liner on the back. People have tried to iron the material on with the liner in place and found it not very successful. Before we start with one very important task to get right, and this, I cannot stress this sufficiently, you must get the temperature of your iron correct. If the temperature of the iron is not correct, then you will not be successful. The easiest thing to do to set the iron temperature is to use a piece of the material itself that you're using. You cut a small square like this, peel the liner off the back, and then put it on the iron and see what effect the heat of the iron has on the material. I'll just put it on gently like that. And you see the material wrinkled up a little bit. It didn't wrinkle up quickly, it was quite slowly, it just sort of squirmed about a bit quite slowly. And that iron is set exactly right for covering with this material. If the iron was too cool, the material would just lie flat on the iron without wrinkling up at all. If the iron was too hot, the material would wrinkle up very quickly and screw itself up into much tighter little wrinkles. That was just about right, and that is the most important thing you've got to do before you start covering a model. Most modelers tend to use an iron that is too hot, and because of that, they very often don't get the best results from the covering they're doing. Anyway, our iron's set correctly. I'm going to cover the undersurface of this wing first. We always do the undersurface first. So we just lie it on like that with the adhesive, the shiny side touching the wood. And we tack it on. That's we attach it at a few points. We usually start at one corner. Just rub it down with the iron. Move to the other corner, make sure the material is lying nice and neatly. Tack it there, that second corner. Then the third corner. And the fourth corner. That's just to hold the material in place while we work on it. Next we have to seal around the perimeter. Seal all the edges down. And the last task is to shrink the material tight in the middle. Now, if we start sealing from this end and go along, we'll find that the looseness in the material will build up and be pushed along to this end of the wing, and we'll finish up with a big wrinkle there, which will be difficult to get rid of. So what we do, we use what we call the divide and half method. We take the midpoint between two of the original tacks, tack it again, and then we do the midpoint between those two. The midpoint again, and so on. The midpoint. When we've tacked it in place, we've then got to seal all the perimeter. And we do this by placing the iron flat on the surface and rolling it round the edge. Now we've sealed all around the perimeter, we can trim off the surplus material. I'm going to use a Stanley knife blade here. We start a small cut. We use the edge of the wood itself as a guide. Then we just seal down those cut edges, make sure the perm is secured down. Then we've sealed the perimeter. The last task is just to shrink the material up. To do that, we just rest the iron quite lightly on the surface and move it slowly across the surface. And we make sure that we treat every part of the fabric with the iron. so it's evenly shrunk all over. With this type of flexible framework, it's a good thing to stop occasionally after you've done a few sections and just check that you're not introducing a warp, because it's very easy to twist the wing slightly and introduce a warp. So you just check and then carry on. That's the panel finished. You've got a nice, tight covering material there. It's airtight, it's fuel-proof, it's waterproof. Of course, I'd do the upper surface next exactly the same way, and I'd overlap the upper covering over the covering on the lower surface by about a quarter of an inch and make sure I seal that overlap down very securely so there was no chance of any fuel getting underneath to the wall. But that is the method used for covering an open structure. Next, we'll cover a solid wooden surface. Now, when we did the open structure, we sealed around the perimeter first of all, and then shrank the middle up later. If we did this with this type of thing, seal around the perimeter, we'd trap a bubble of air on the material which couldn't get away, and this would stop the material from sticking down properly on the wood. So we have to use a completely different technique here. We actually start in the middle and work outwards, pushing the air out ahead of the iron. So I'm going to use some solar film for this. This type of structure is very, very strong. It's very, very stiff. For that reason, we usually use a film. We don't need the strength of the fabric. So we'll take our backing sheet off, discard it, lay our material on. Now let's just check our iron temperature again. Remember, this is the most important thing, to get the iron temperature right. We cut a bit of film, a little square of film, and we put it on the iron. Oh dear, just a minute. I forgot to take the backing sheet off that. So we've got to make sure we get rid of that first before we can do it. Even the experts can make silly mistakes. Well, there's our iron, and there the material shrink, wrinkled up a little bit. You see, they're very small wrinkles. If it shriveled up into a tight little ball, the iron is far, far too hot, and you'll ruin the covering. So that iron is just about right, and we can start off. We start in the middle, just resting the iron gently on the surface, and iron outwards. Now if you examine that closely, we've got a saucer shape in the middle here with a sort of a ridge around it. If we carry on ironing down on that ridge, we'll make creases in the material and you'll get some nasty little marks on the surface that you can't get rid of. So what we have to do here, we have to grit the material at the edge here and pull it so that ridge here disappears. Then we iron that section down, always working outwards from the middle. Here we've got the ridge, so we grit the material, thumb and finger here, and pull it. Thank you. Once again, we seal around the edges, seal them over the corners, as it were. Rolling them around the edges. We trim off as before. Now, a word of caution here. In this type of structure, the entire strength of the wing is in that thin veneer on the surface of the foam. If I use a blade and cut across there, I'm going to cut into the veneer, which could seriously weaken the wing. You can imagine this is only one panel, and if the other panel was here, and I weakened the veneer in that place, then we would have a very weak wing, which would be a risk of it folding up and collapsing in mid-air. So we mustn't cut the material on the veneer. What you need is a strip of sticky tape. Which we put the edge exactly along the line we want to trim the material off. Just push it further down like that. And then we start a very small cut in the film. And we peel the film off. Pull it off across the tape at 45 degrees. That gives us a perfectly nice straight edge. We just remove the tape. And then iron the material down. That way there's no risk whatsoever of damaging or weakening the wing by cutting the veneer. We haven't quite finished yet. We want to make sure that film is stuck down all over the veneer. The reason for this is if it's stuck in every place, there's less chance of it wrinkling up or bubbling up later on in the model's life. So we just reheat the material section by section with the iron, and while it's hot, we rub it down with a soft cloth. We repeat that over the whole surface. That's how you cover a solid surface. Start at the middle and work outwards. Now for the third task, the double curvature. I've got a wing tip here. I've not got it on the wing, it's on a little stand, because it's a lot easier to see what is happening when it's like this. But it's just the same when it's on the end of the wing. I'm going to use solar film here again. I'm going to use blue, take our liner off. We'll just check our iron temperature. I haven't altered it since I did the solid surface wing. We'll just put a little bit of film on it, on the iron, and you see it wrinkles up very slightly and very slowly. So the iron temperature is quite correct. Rest our material on. Just tack it at the middle. Hold it in place while we work on it, and then I grip it with my finger and thumb and stretch it a little bit round the front. And I right the way around, stretch the rear, and iron it all the way around. When you come to bend it over and trying to make it lie down on the tip, you find there's far too much material here, a lot of slackness, a lot of looseness. And what we do, we take a little piece of it, this little piece here, for example, this little area here. I'm going to grip the material with finger and thumb. I'm going to heat that little section of the film. When it gets nice and hot, I'm going to pull it round and pull it down onto the wood. But while I'm heating it, I actually pull it gently and keep it away from the wood. This is most important. So I'm gripping it with my finger and thumb. I just rest the iron on it, get the film nice and warm. And once it's warm, you pull it round. That little bit where it's curved round, we can actually iron it down on the wood to seal it down in place. And then we do that all the way along. We do this little bit next, we heat it, stretch, and iron it down. Heat, stretch, and iron it down. One side, we turn it around and do the other side exactly the same way. There we are. I'll just trim off the surface film with our blade. There it is. We've covered it in that direction and in that direction. There's no wrinkles, it's perfectly smooth, even surface. Very easy to do. The secret is to heat the film, stretch it until it's the right shape, and then iron it down on the wood. If you iron any of the wrinkles down before you've stretched it, then you will make those wrinkles permanent. You will never get rid of them. But that's how you do a double curvature. So we've done all three techniques now. We can cover open frameworks, we can cover solid surfaces, and we can cover double curvature. And when you look at a model aircraft, you will find the open frameworks and the solid surfaces are very easy to identify, but you'll find there are a lot of double curvature on all models. Not only wing tips, wherever the corner of tail planes, the corner of fins, engine cowlings, there's all little areas of double curvature which you're going to use this technique on. But it's essential that you should be able to do those three tasks, and when you're covering a model, decide which of the three tasks you're doing and use the correct technique for that particular task. Now that we've seen how to do the basic operations when covering a model, the next thing really is to consider how we can use the different colours to produce colour schemes on a model. What I've got here is a small free flight model. It's diesel powered, it's covered in light span, and this is the first sort of thing that is done to introduce colour schemes on a model, just by doing the wings in a different colour to the fuselage. This is very simple, straightforward. It doesn't need a lot of imagination to do this sort of thing. The rest of this video, though, we shall introduce this product, solar trim. And this is a material that's very useful for doing colour schemes on a model. But first of all, we'll just run through some different models and see what can be done with this material and how the different schemes are done, how the different colour schemes are introduced on a model. Here we have another small free flight model. Again, it's covered in light span. We've gone a little bit further on the colour scheme here by using two different colours, white and orange. We've covered the wings up to the main spar in white and the rest of the wing in orange light span. Now, when this wing was covered, the rear part of the wing was covered in orange first, and then the white was put on after, overlapping onto the orange along the main spar. It's very difficult to get an exactly straight line along a main spar when you're overlapping two materials like that. So along this main spar here, we've covered the joint with a very narrow black line called a cheat line. This is just a strip of black light span that's been ironed on after the model was covered. It does enhance the difference in colour between the two sections. Now here we've got a vintage model. The colour schemes are a little step further on from the orange and white model we've just seen. This is actually a Quaker Flash. I think it's a 1936 design, and the original model was probably covered in coloured silk. On this model we've represented the coloured silk by some vintage yellow Solartex. This is a translucent colour. You can actually see the structure through the yellow covering, and it does represent the coloured silk very nicely. We've also used some black Glosstex to contrast with the yellow, and you will see that although we've done the joint line along the main spar between the black and yellow, we've also introduced some curves here and here. And this does enhance the scheme quite a lot. Later on in this, I'll explain the sequence we've used in covering this model and how we cut these curves out accurately and get them all exactly the same. Now this is a full model, a 40-powered low-wing aerobatic model, the sort of model you use for punching holes in the sky. It does use the solar trim material, the first model I've shown you using solar trim material. It's a veneered foam wing, a solid balsa sheet fuselage and sheet balsa tail surfaces. The whole model was covered in yellow solar film to start with, and then the black design was put on afterwards using pieces of solar trim cut out to shape. It's a very simple scheme, it's very effective, and it does illustrate one point about colour schemes on the model. When the model's flying against a light coloured sky, you need some dark areas to the model which will show up clearly against the bright sky. But then when you're coming into land and the model drops below the skyline, you really need a light, bright colour to show up against that background. And this is why we use this bright yellow. So basically on a model, when you're designing a colour scheme, you should bear that in mind. A dark colour to show up against the sky, and a very light colour to show up against the green fields or trees when you're bringing the model into land. Here we have the same design and model, but with a different colour scheme. This is a white solar film covered model. It was covered entirely in white solar film to begin with, And then the coloured design was stuck on afterwards using pieces of solar trim cut out to shape. It's a little bit more complex, it takes a little bit more time to do, but it's a very effective scheme. It's done the same underneath and on top. We've got this rather nice eagle design along the fuselage side. I'll deal with how to get this sort of thing later on. I'll describe how we design the thing, how we get the cutout shapes and everything. With this type of scheme, of course, you're only limited by your imagination with the things you can do. Here we have a full size, what I call a full size pattern aerobatic model. This is powered by a 62 stroke with a tuned pipe. The scheme on it is done mainly in white solar film. Certain areas have been covered in dark blue solar film, particularly the top of the fuselage here, and also the wing tips were done in dark blue solar film. The rest of the design, the red and the blue on the wings and the fuselage, those were done in solar trim. And finally, the cowling, which is a complex two-dimensional shape, this was actually painted with solar lac. And this does bring a nice point out about the solar film materials. You can get a paint, a film and the trim material in identical colours. And it does make it rather easy to do complex schemes like this where, because of the shape of the components, some of them are best filmed, some are best done with solar trim, but other parts have to be painted. And on this model you can't really tell which of the materials is which because they're all exactly the same colour. The person who built this model said that because he was learning to fly aerobatics, he really needed to know which way up the model was when it was flying. So he decided he wanted a completely different scheme on the underside to the top surface. And I'll turn the model up, and you'll see the undersurface is a completely different colour scheme. We've got the red and white checks. Later on I'll show how we do this checkerboard system. It's very easy to do with solar trim. Here we have a powered glider. This one was done as a test model for our polyester film solar coat. It was covered about 4 or 5 years ago. We weren't using up all the odd bits and pieces of colours that we had lying around. We just covered each panel in a different colour so we could test all the colours of the material on the model and see if we kept the model how the long-term durability of this material was. Once again, if you look, you'll see that we've used the little cheat lines where two colours meet. This is an easy way of hiding that joint, and it does enhance the contrast between two colours of film. On the glider, you'll notice that one of the wing tips has been done in a separate colour, a completely different colour. And this is a way of incorporating the wingtip in the colour scheme. Here we've got a blue wingtip and the undersurface is orange, the upper surface is a light green. We've already seen how to do these on the original part of the video where we talk about this as being a double curvature. There are other ways of dealing with wingtips and I'll mention those because these sometimes cause a little bit of uncertainty for beginners. Just what do they do with wing tips when they're building the model. We'll look at some more wing tips now. Here's another double curvature wing tip. On this one, we haven't covered it separately. We've just carried the main covering on along the upper surface and around the wing tip, treating it as a double curvature and trimming it off neatly along the edge of the wing tip. This one's white underneath, dark blue on top. That's another way of dealing with the double curvature wing tip. Now this is a different kind of wing tip. This is a wing tip on a built-up wing made of spars, ribs, and the wing tip is made from a shaped piece of balsa wood sheet glued on the end of the wing and it's braced with these triangular braces to the tip rim. Now, the undersurface of the wing is almost completely flat, so it's been easy enough to carry the covering on, the undersurface covering, straight round to the end of the wing tip. But when we get to the upper surface, we find that there's quite a sharp change of direction at the tip rim. And if you try to carry that upper surface covering on and complete the covering of the wingtip, you would find it very difficult because you would get wrinkles. You'll find this is a general rule when you're covering models, that where you get a sudden change of direction in a piece of covering, then usually you have to do that using two separate pieces of covering. That's the general rule. And in this case, we're going to do that. So this covering has been trimmed off, the upper surface trimmed off along the end rim, and then we're going to cover the tip itself with a completely separate piece of covering. Because that separate piece of covering has to fit accurately along the tip rib, then what we do is we get a piece of paper and cut ourselves a pattern. We put a piece of paper . Slope it down as though it were the covering, and then we draw along the tip rib and cut that out, and we get a pattern which shows the curve that we will have to put in the covering material before we iron it on the wing tip. I'll do it with a piece of blue covering so that it will contrast with the yellow. We get our pattern, we draw the shape on the pattern, and we cut that out. Then we can iron this on in the normal manner. And then we could trim that off, trim the surface off, and then shrink the material carefully with the iron. We get a nice tight covering on the wingtip without any wrinkles or anything to spoil it. Now we'll deal with this Quaker flash wing. We covered with two different colours, the vintage yellow Solartex and the black Glosstex. I'll go through the sequence that this wing is covered in just to give us an example. These curves that we've got in the colour scheme here on the wing, I cut a cardboard pattern or a template so that I could cut those curves accurately in the covering material before I applied it to the model. Here I've got a drawing of that wing in outline, a small drawing, and I'll just run through the sequence in which the covering is applied. The wing is in three sections, three panels. There's a short, flat centre section, and then the two main outer panels sloping outwards and upwards from the centre section. Covering this wing, we always start off with the centre section, and we start off with a piece of yellow Solartex from the main spar back over the trailing edge. That's the initial one. Then we apply the pieces of Solartex on the panels, the yellow pieces, from the main spar back across the trailing edge, overlapping that piece that we've already put on the centre. There's the second one. Next, we apply the gloss, the black gloss. And we start with a piece this shape, and we've pre-cut those curves in the piece of black. And we apply that over the top of the yellow, at the centre section. Like so. And then a similar thing with the pre-cut curves applied on each wing tip. The outer edges are left oversize until after the covering material has been ironed on, and then they're trimmed to size afterwards. Next, we apply a piece of black on the front of the centre section so that it overlaps the black we've already put on. Then lastly, we apply the black on each wingtip being careful to make sure that the straight lines blend into those curves smoothly. And lastly, the third piece. You would do that on the under surface first, and then repeat again on the top surface. And the fuselage is done in a similar manner. Now we'll deal with the methods used to make that checkerboard that we saw on the underside of that aerobatic model. We've got to decide what the colour scheme is first. I'm going to do some black squares on a white surface. And the first thing we have to do, we have to draw the squares accurately on the back of the solar trim we're going to use. Now you might find there's a little bit of a problem here that the back of the solar trim will not accept the bar or any other marker. This is because there are small traces of the release agent on it. It's very easy to deal with. You want a small amount of thinner or solvent on a little bit of tissue, and then you just wipe the back of the trim with that, and the solvent wipes away the release agent, and then you can mark on your squares. You'll find the barrel will mark on quite well, and then the next stage is to cut those squares out. You cut the material into strips first, and then cut out the squares. Next, you've got to put some reference line to start off the pattern. I've used a piece of masking tape here, and I've marked on that tape the distances, 1.5 inches in this case, the size of the squares. Now you must get that accurately straight, and the distances must be accurate, otherwise as you start putting the squares on, you will find they will diverge, you will get all sorts of awkward gaps. The usual thing, you turn back the backing off the trim for a short distance and fold it back so you expose the sticky underside of the trim, and then we position that accurately where we want it to go on the model. Press the sticky bit down, and then we pull the backing off like so and rub the trim off. We repeat this with successive squares of trim. So, very simple, very straightforward. Now we'll do how you get those cheek lines, the stripes of solar trim. You need to make yourself a little tool, what I call a twin cutter. I'm going to make one here. I've got a piece of balsa wood. The thickness is the same as the width of the trim line I want. I've got two blades, two Stanley knife blades. I put them one on each side of the balsa wood. And then a piece of sticky tape wrap around them. To fasten them on the balsa wood. That's your twin cutter. And we'll cut ourselves a stripe. We'll work on the face of the trim. There's our cheek line. Thin, narrow stripe of black. I'll put it on this wing that I put the chequers on, just to give an edge to that area of black and white checks. The usual technique, we peel back a small part of the liner, stick the end there, pull the liner back under the trim. That's our cheek line. You will find that the solar trim, when you cut a cheek line, it will not fit round the curve smoothly, it will wrinkle up. So if you want any curved cheek lines, you have to cut a cardboard template like I've got here, put it on the trim, use your twin cutter and use it to cut round that curve. There we've got our curved piece of trim. Very, very often when we're working with trim and trimming materials, it's very much worthwhile to cut yourself patterns or templates and use those to cut out the shapes. It will save you a lot of time. It'll probably save you wasting a lot of material as well. So do use paper patterns, paper templates or cardboard templates whenever you need to do. Now we'll move on to something a little bit more complex. We'll put a three-colour trim scheme on this small white wing. The first thing is a standard technique, this actually, is that you get a piece of white paper and you draw around the component, get the outline. And then within that outline, you design the scheme you want. I've done a very simple one here. I've drawn three parallel lines, half an inch wide, starting here, going out to that point there. And at that point, the design changes into three triangular pieces. I'm going to do this scheme in a light blue, the heather, and the violet colour. Cutting the three half-inch wide parallel pieces is quite easy. The three triangular pieces, I actually cut a paper pattern. And I use that paper pattern to cut my pieces of solar trim. I've cut those ready, they're all here. Now the next step is to get or mark the critical points of the design from the paper onto the wing. And I've marked three points here. I've marked the start point where the design starts at the leading edge of the wing, and I've measured that. Marked it onto the wing itself. The second point is here where the design changes from parallel stripes to triangles. This point here, which I measured from the leading edge, and I've transferred that onto the wing. Marked it with that V shape. And the last point is where the design leaves the wing tip here, which I've also marked on the wingtip there. So I've got the three critical points of the design on the wing. Now it's a standard technique with this. We take our pieces of trim, peel the line back, beginning. I think I'd better start from here where the design changes from parallel to a triangle. We stick it down part of the heather on next. the violet last. Now we'll add the triangular pieces. Same technique, peel the end back. Press the end down. I've left the surplus on, the excess material there on the triangles. The way we cut that off is we put the blade down exactly along the line we want the trim to come off. Then we pull the trim up and pull it up against that sharp edge of the blade, which gives an accurate line. Then we finish this off by cutting between the wing and the aileron. And pushing the trim round the corner onto the back of the wing and onto the leading edge of the aileron. There's our design. Now, a problem that people frequently meet when they come to use this material, solar trim, is that the first time they unroll the roll, they find it won't lie flat. And they really need to make it lie flat too. Be able to cut it out. So the obvious thing is to roll it the other way around to try and take the curl out of the paper. Now we've got it to lie flat, but we've run up against another problem. We've got these rather annoying wrinkles across the sheet. These will interfere with the cutting out if you're trying to cut straight lines. Where you get the material riding up in wrinkles like that, you will get a little, you won't get a straight line, you'll get a little wiggle in the line. And this, I know from comments I've heard, that this causes an awful lot of frustration for modelers. And the solution is very, very simple. What you have to do, you have to take the solar trim flat down in the middle like this. We peel the end back about 2 inches. We need to fasten that backing paper down onto the board. Now I should really have some double-sided tape here, but I haven't got any. So I'll use single-sided tape and two pieces overlapping. Like so. Then we get a strip of balsa wood or a piece of dowel which we attach on the end of the trim. Then we hold the trim down with one hand, lift the material off the backing up to the tape, and then we use our ruler, or you can use the empty tube that you got out of the sheet, and you just smooth the material back down. If it's not quite right, you can peel it up a bit. And that gets the material back down smoothly onto the backing sheet without any wrinkles, and you'll find it will lie nice and flat. Without any problems while you work with it. Of course you do the same again from the other end. And it's really worthwhile storing the material after you've done that. Store it flat between two thick pieces of cardboard, then you can always keep it flat. Now we'll go on to something a little bit more complicated. This Crystal Eagle design here. The wings started off basically covered in white solar film, and these pieces of solar trim have been added afterwards. So we'll go through the sequence to do this type of scheme. Our white wing, and we draw around it. To get our outline. And then within that outline, we design our scheme. You can see I've drawn it in here red. There are some of the construction lines, this line along the tip of the feathers, and the intermediate lines. We draw that out and get that reasonably accurate to start with. Once we've got that, we copy that, trace it, onto a second piece of paper, and from that second piece of paper we cut out the various shapes. That was the red. There's the yellow, the black, and so on. So that you finish up with paper patterns like this one, which you're going to use to cut the trim from, and the remaining piece, which I call the mask, this piece, which is the the white shapes in between the feathers. And we're going to use that mask to mark on the wing the points of the scheme. We place the mask on the wing, and then we mark out various points in the design, such as the tip of the feathers, and so on. So on the wing, you finish up with some reference points that you can use to align your trim to later on. The next stage is to cut out the solar trim itself. I'm not going to do all of them, I'll just do the red to start with. I'm using a cutting mat here, and I've cut four pieces of solar trim, red solar trim. The reason I'm using four is that we need two left-hand designs and two right-hand designs for the four surfaces of the wing. So I'm going to put them together in pairs, face to face. So, take that down onto my cutting surface. Use plenty of tape so the material won't be able to move about while you're cutting it. Then on that we place our pattern, the paper pattern. Which we tape down. And then we start cutting that out with a straight edge. For the curved pieces, I find a set of plastic French curves are very handy. They help you to get very smooth curves. Then we've got all of our set of red feathers, and we'll have three other sets here. And of course you'll have all the other colours cut out. The blue and yellow and orange and so on. We'll just put one set of red feathers on just to show you the technique. Now we're going to use something new here. We're going to do a method called floating. If you try and peel this material off the backing paper dry and then try and apply it dry, you'll find it very difficult to get them down smoothly without any wrinkles or bubbles, because it's such a complicated shape. You could do it about 6 or 7 hands to do it that way. So what we're going to do, we've got a bowl of water here, and we're going to put a few drops of washing up liquid in it. There's a wetting agent. We'll stir that in. Then we put our trim in it. We actually peel the paper off under the water. We take our wing, wet the surface with the water. We actually put the material on. Using our reference point. Now the water helps you to slide the material about until it's in exactly the right place in relation to the marks. And then we take a pad of dry tissue and squeegee the water out. Like so. Now if you can't get it right, you can always peel it off again, put it back in the water and have another try. Now this technique with the water, I call it floating, and it allows you to handle quite big and complex shapes of solar trim without introducing wrinkles or bubbles, and it's very, very efficient. Of course, you'll do the orange here and the yellow here, the blue and the black. Last thing I've got to show you is the use of solar trim for making insignia, like these roundels here, this American star, the invasion stripes and so on. If you're going to do any insignia, it's worthwhile getting our insignia sheet from the factory. I've got one here. This gives you the proportions of all the most popular insignia, the roundels, the stars, the swastikas and so on. There's a certain amount of instructions on how to do this technique, and there's also a method of producing a scaling diagram. Now this is a scaling diagram which allows you to change the proportions from this sheet into actual measurements of the coloured pieces of solar trim you're going to cut out to make an insignia. Also on this sheet there's a diagram for marking out 5-pointed stars accurately. This is something not easy to do, but using this diagram you'll find it very, very easy. And just to illustrate how easy it is to make insignia out of solar trim, I'm going to make a roundel. The three colours you would use most often in making insignias, the white, the dark red and the dark blue. These are the colours that are most frequently used in insignia. I'm going to use a little gadget here called a circle cutter. How to make one of these out of bits and bobs in your scrap box is given at the bottom of the insignia sheet here. It doesn't require anything very sophisticated. What I'm going to do, I'm going to make a 7-inch roundel using this scaling diagram here. We actually take the measurements directly off the scaling diagram. That's the setup for the blue circle we're going to need. Very simple. Put your circle cutter on your material and pull the material around under the cutter. Like so. Now we peel the blue off around the outside of the circle. That's the base on which we're going to assemble our roundel. We reset our circle cutter off the scaling diagram for the white disc. Drop that in the water. Take the trim off under the water. Next, the red. Set the circle cutter. Wet the blue. Apply the white. Just check the measurements to make sure that that white is absolutely in the middle. That's correct. And then we apply the red. There's your completed insignia. Now, you'll put that in a warm place for about 24 hours to dry out thoroughly. It does have a glossy surface at the moment, but if you want a matte surface, after it's dried out, you get a piece of damp cloth, a damp tissue, some Ajax abrasive cleaning powder, kitchen cleaner, and then you just abrade the surface gently to make it as dull or as matte as required. When you come to apply it to the model, you will wet the surface of the model. Let's take a wing, we wet the surface of the model. peel the complete insignia off underwater, and then float it in place. You can do all sorts of different roundels. I've got a one with the yellow in. You can do American insignia, like the star, white star and bars, a blue base with a white star, and two white bars added.